Mr. Niraj, I kindly request you to proceed with the presentation, please.
So, dignitaries on the dais, ladies and gentlemen, a very good afternoon to you. We begin this session with a presentation, basically a warm-up for the panel discussion, where we will go through the key amendments which has been proposed by the government. As we understand, the bill has been passed by the parliament and now it is waiting the presidential assent. So after a period of 1 year, it was time to take stock and look at the key legislative requirements, amendments which are required to be undertaken. We have seen a flurry of circulars and notifications being issued in last 1 year. So this is after a period of 1 year where the government has moved in to make certain changes in law based on the experience they have derived over a period of 1 year. The first amendment, if you look at, is basically in the section 7, which talks about supply. So under the previous law, there was a clause in 7.1d which covered basically deemed supply transactions. So transactions which otherwise may or may not qualify as supply would have got covered because of the entries which were contained in Schedule 2. This was causing an anomalous interpretation of law, which the government has sought to rectify by making an amendment to suggest that all Schedule 2 entries will first have to satisfy the definition of a supply, and then it could be taken to whether or not it will be subject to taxation. So Schedule 2 now basically remains a more of a classification schedule to determine whether any supply would be goods or services. If it does not satisfy the test of a supply, they will not be subject to tax. So a case in point is one of the hotly debated topics is in the case of liquidated damages, where recently a couple of advanced rulings have been pronounced to suggest that they would be subject to tax. Going forward, and while this is a retrospective amendment, one will have to again revisit these positions to see whether the liquidated damages, first of all, qualify as a supply or not, and then only it can be considered for taxation. The next amendment is again a beneficial amendment which has been undertaken. A lot of issues were being raised relating to high sea sale and out and out supply, where basically, let's say you are buying in China and supplying to your customer in United States, whether that could be subject to tax in India. A sale within a custom bonded warehouse where goods have been imported into the country and then the bill of entry is filed for the clearance from the bonded warehouse. While the sale happens, the goods are located in the bonded warehouse. There were issues as to whether the supplier would be required to charge IGST and thereafter again pay IGST while filing the bill of entry at the time of clearance. The government's stated position was that they should not be subject to tax. They had come out with a circular in the month of November. However, something which is enshrined in the legislation has to be amended so that no disputes take place in future. And thankfully, they have taken the, this opportunity to make amendments in the law to consider these transactions as not subject to tax. And they have also extended the benefit of input tax credit. While no tax is applicable on these transactions, the assessees will not lose out on input tax credit for these transactions. What does remain unanswered is the fact that it is not going to be amended retrospectively. So till the time this amendment happens, these questions on taxability and if it is an exempt transaction, how do you deal with the input tax credit would continue to remain. The next amendment is something which seemed to address the fund settlement between the center and the state so far as IGST is concerned. So two amendments were made, and why I'm making this point is maybe the next slide will explain how it can actually have an impact on the working capital of the company. The intent is to ensure that whatever IGST credit that you have, you first utilize it towards payment of taxes, be it IGST, CGST or SGST, so that the fund gets earmarked what can be distributed to the state. So when I'm using an IGST credit for an SGST liability, that amount is quantified and therefore the center can share it with the state government. Similarly, the SGST credit should be utilized against the IGST liability only after the CGST credits have been used. So this is again been made to ensure that there is no flow from state to the center and it is being taken only as a last resort. Now, if you look at the first amendment and look at this example, how this can actually impact your working capital. In the first table, we are talking about a situation where you have an IGST liability, IGST credit, and the way the law is worded today, basically my IGST credit, if I can use the phrase, is a joker in the pack. In the sense, I can use it against IGST, CGST or SGST depending on where the shortfall is. But as per the proposed law, I am forced to use the IGST credit first. So even though, let's say, I have a CGST balance or an SGST balance, first I have to exhaust all the IGST credits. Now this may lead to a situation, let's say in this example, where the SGST output is 80 rupees and the credit is 60 rupees, but because my IGST credit has been used to pay this liability first, I am left with a situation where I'm having surplus balance in SGST account, and therefore which will entail a cash payment of taxes. So while I do have credits lying in CGST account, as in this example, I will have to make the payment of tax in cash, which would not have happened, let's say, in the current scenario where IGST was used as a last resort. So while the intent was to minimize the flow of fund between center and the states on settlement of liability, this, I think, is an unintended consequence, and we'll have to see how this has to be dealt with. Two more amendments relating to place of supply. The first one is to provide a level playing field in case of transportation of goods, where goods are being taken outside India, basically an export transaction, where the place of supply has been changed to the destination of goods. So while the intention is to make this transaction as not taxable, but the way we, when we read the law, this amendment has been undertaken in Section 12, which basically deals with a situation where the supplier and recipient both are located in India. Now, in order for a transaction to qualify as an export transaction, it has to fall within the realm of Section 13, which means that there has to be a receipt in foreign currency. So if my recipient is in India and naturally he is not going to make the payment in foreign currency, the intention of making it tax-free, we believe, may not be successful, because there is a provision under Section 7 which says that if it is an interstate supply and it is not subject to tax otherwise, or rather when there is a supplier or recipient which are located in India as well as outside India, it will be deemed to be an interstate supply which will suffer tax. So I think they'll have to go and make an amendment to ensure that these transactions are not taxed as an interstate supply. With this, I would move on to the panel presentation so that we can take up some of these questions which arise because of the changes that I proposed to take in place.
Thank you, Mr. Bagri. What are the key takeaways from the proposed amendments for his individual sectors? This is one. And coupled with that, it'll be there, what are the specific or critical amendments which the industry was looking for but remains unaddressed in the proposed amendments? Like in the inaugural session, Mr. Shailendra Kumar had mentioned that there are number of 46 amendments were there, but then there are many more situations where, which was perhaps recommended by the law committee and other committees, but it has not been taken care of. So in the meantime, so we will discuss here that what are the things where they have been felt left out. So now we can start with from.
Sure. Yeah, please. Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I think if we were to just look at amendments, but we step back a little, I think what we have seen in last 1 year has been a steep learning curve for all of us, whether it is government or whether it is assessees. And now what we see, things have stabilized to a major extent. And these amendments are now further to take away the pain points, simplify the processes, and help both assessee as well as government to ensure it is a better compliance. So I think from that point of view, directionally, if I were to say, I think these are very welcome amendments that have been proposed, whether it is in the forms of combining the returns or whether it is in the forms of allowing the foreign exchange in the Indian rupees, etc. So they are very, very positive from that point of view. There are still some areas which perhaps can be looked into to see whether we can further improve upon the compliance, etc. And I'll talk specifically from the FMCG sector, since I come from FMCG side. One of the areas that I see is with regard to the free issues, which has also been discussed yesterday. We saw in the Economic Times where it's a common practice among the industry to provide one for one free, etc. And therefore, the important thing is when it is a consolidated product and consumer is buying, whether the input credit should be allowed to that. So I think there have been discussions, and there seems to be positive indications, but it is helpful in case if that gets clarified and it is cleared, so there are no ambiguities, etc. So I think that's one area perhaps we are looking forward to. The other one is with regard to the concept of deemed supply, when it is being talked about the disposal of asset without consideration, that comes with regard to POS materials, etc., where it is in the furtherance of business, whether the input credit can be available on that. I think that's the other area which one could look at. And another one area perhaps one could look at would be that I think it's a welcome move when they have said that the canteen services that has been provided to employees, it's going to be 5% on output without taking the input credit. But having said that, when the employer is paying to the contractor, it's already incurring 5%. So whether the transition is permitted, I think that's one area one could look at. Similarly, we talked about simplification of returns, and a lot has been talked, so I'll not go into the details. But one area where we have seen from the past that there have been disruption on account of whether the volume can be taken, whether the testing can be permitted. And from that point of view, if and it has been also communicated in earlier session, if there are enough time and practice available, time is available to the SSCs and from the government side, I think the transition will become very, very smooth. So I think these are some of the thoughts that I had, and I'll just hand over to you next.
Thank you, Mr. Malik. Thank you. Mr. Sreekumar?
Yeah, I'm from cement industry. In the previous sessions, they were talking about cement industry untouchable because it's the revenue receiving for the government and the high so-called SIM rate of tax of 28%. Someone asked a question, they said, sorry, it can be reduced. So leave apart that. There are some good points in the sense we have a lot of dealers and vendors, multiple credit notes being issued for every invoice was a pain point for us. Now this will be a very good thing for us to get things done faster. Things will be easier for us. For another point, which I think it is good for us. Then the expansion of this ITC, as you was just mentioning about the factory canteens, etc. It's another point which I think should be good for an industry. Negative things, anyway, it's sin industry, so.
Thank you. Mr. Qureshi, please.
Yes, so I come from the export sector and primarily services sector, really. So I think one of the really good things which has happened for us is the eligibility of input tax credit, which they are now trying to increase. And rather than having a long list, I think they are going to basically, I think they're trying to bring in transportation, buses and commercial vehicles, though I don't understand why that it should be limited to only 13 passengers and above. There are a lot of companies or transporters which provide cabs and which are used by taxpayers for transporting their employees. So while it's a very welcome move, but I'm not sure putting a limit of 13 people was really the right thing to do. Maybe we could have just made it something across the board. Anybody who's using, genuinely using vehicles, commercial vehicles, which could include taxis also for transporting employees, I think that would have been more welcome. But in any case, I think for the IT industry, for the BPM, airlines, hotel industry, this is a big one. That we have been able to achieve. I think the other one is on this the reverse charge. So right now it was anyway deferred till 30th September, but now I think they are anyway trying to prune that list, and hopefully we'll have some more reasonable list on which a reverse charge would have to be paid if you buy from unregistered dealers. So those are the two good things which I clearly see. I'm sure there are many others. I think on the what could have been done better, so again, this is not really a GST Act issue which I'm trying to highlight now. There's more to do with the rules. But one of the things we have been fighting for long, the export services industry, is this anomaly which exists in the formula on how your refund should be computed. While in the numerator, you are allowed to take only receipts, in the denominator, you take the entire billing. which actually leads to a major leakage of your refunds. And we have been representing on this for the last almost 1 year, even more than that. I mean, somewhere the policymakers understand the issue, but it is not very clear whether there is some kind of resistance or this is just falling through the cracks somewhere. But clearly, this is something which needs to be addressed. So while the government keeps on pushing refund melas and refund fortnights, but I think those are primarily benefiting the goods industry. The service industry has a huge issue because of this one single issue because of the formula. That is just not getting addressed, and people have not been able to file hundreds of crores of refunds, not been able to file at all. So forget disposal by the government. We have not been able to file. So I think that clearly is something which needs to be addressed.
Yeah, that really the refund area continues to be an area of concern, and I suppose Tax India Online, Mr. Shinde Kumar will sum up the whole things and make a paper presented to the GST Council and the Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs. I think this area and certain other things which are being mentioned here should be brought to their notice so that it is on record.
I think Mr. Qureshi is absolutely right. The first initial few months where probably you would not have got the receipts of the billing done in July.
Yeah.
So there are several companies for first few months they were not able to file a single refund claim because the money, the payment would have started coming in only after 2 to 3 months down the line.
And in fact, the other thing which again, sorry, it's a little detailed here.
Yeah,
but the other thing which they are also doing here is they are not allowing you in the receipts, even in the receipts, they are not allowing you receipts for your pre-July billings, which clearly is you are trying to really compare apples with oranges.
Yeah.
You cannot get credit for that in the service tax because the money was never received. You are not giving credit for that in GST because they are saying, oh, GST was born only on 1st of July. How can we give you a credit for billing that you did before that?
That's right.
So this is an area of concern. So we will highlight this to you. Thank you, Mr. Qureshi. Now, Mr. Devarajan, you can give your views.
Yeah, good afternoon, friends. So I thought I should start with congratulating each one of you. I mean, I found the government people appreciating themselves. GST and portal takes credit for whatever it has done. Why not indirect tax team belonging to each one of you, your company, supply chain, commercial? You have done a wonderful job in the past 1 year in implementing the GST. Mr. Shailendra was trying to count the notification. It is 300 plus notifications the past 1.5 years. It is 100 plus circulars and orders the past 1 year, 3 months. Friends, I don't even remember how many I would have read. So reading all these things, it's mind-boggling. Ensuring you put your ERP in place, dispatching, exporting, and coming to the extent of claiming a refund, I think you guys have done a wonderful, fantastic job. Be proud of it. In that words, I thought I should start with my comments. On the refund front, I thought I should start. It's a favorite topic probably for each one of us. While appreciating the government on the IGST refunds, which we fortunately are getting through the shipping bills, the Rule 89, that is accumulated credit refunds, is in shambles. Let me assure you, it will add fuel to the big fire. Is that if you are with the state government authority as the jurisdictional authority, you are in complete mess. When I filed my claim for export of services and went and approached the state government assessing authority, he said that I don't understand anything of this called export of service. My refund claims are pending right from the month of July. This is the status of refunds. And I mean, God save you if you are with the state government authority. Fortunately, if you are with the central government authority, they understand this because of the earlier erstwhile refund claim rule 5. So they understand things better. They proceed further better. But with the system glitches as pointed out by Mr. Qureshi, yesterday there is a new glitch arisen, the invoice value and the realization if there is a mismatch, we are not able to upload the refund claim. That is the latest in the GSTN problem. So refunds, to say the least, is in shambles, Rule 89. With regard to the amendments, let me quickly share my thought process. Dhruva can say, Section 43A amendment was a very good amendment, which has been introduced for the new return. You know what, earlier the matching process was suspended by the government, but in spite of that, all of us, most of us have got notices on mismatches. Am I right? Well, the council said that matching process is under suspension, but at least my company, in my industry, chemical and pharma, we have got 4 notices saying that there is a mismatch between your 2A and a 3B, which is not there in the law. 2A and 3B, that should be very clear. Now, when I went and checked with all my so-called tax experts and whatever minimum knowledge we industry guys have got, I found that section 16 is a very draconian section. It says that unless tax is paid by the other fellow, you can't take the credit. So any of my authorities are saying, I don't care about the council. The law says that you will have, unless that fellow pays the tax, you can't take the credit. So net-net, my notices were justified. Any number of consultants, we consult, they say, sir, go out with your reconciliation and submit the reply. Otherwise, you will end up in a problem. So net-net, in spite of the matching process being put under suspension or whatever, industry is facing this problem and it can magnify in the coming days. Now, fortunately, this has been addressed in 43A, where they said that notwithstanding anything contained in 16. This was not there in the original draft. I think many of the industry members, including we, have taken up this point, because in spite of the new procedure, the state government people will come back to you again and say the tax not paid, you please pay me the credit, in spite of all these new returns and others. So this was draconian. So now what they have done is, fortunately for us, in 43A, they start with notwithstanding what is stated in 16. It's a very important point for each one of us. I think probably we have missed it or whatever. But did you see 43A4, anybody? They have put a restriction of 20% on the credit if outward supplies are not being filed by supplier. I don't know how many of you have seen that. None of us discussed that as a part of the business process of the new return. I am not sure what is this 20% restriction, when this will apply, and how it is going to hurt each one of us. It's a very important point. Please have a relook at 43A4. Then coming to enlargement, I think we were all happy that the ITC is going to be, input tax credit is going to be enlarged. Gentlemen, I am telling you one thing, have a close look at the anti-profiteering provisions. It says that if you are going to get any additional credit, this has to be passed on. Now we can sit and argue whether this will be applicable there, but let me assure you, such proceedings are already taking place in the National Anti-Profiteering Authority Forum. So, you may argue with me, we can discuss separately. Fact of the matter is, if you get any additional credits, whether the anti-profiteering provision will be applicable, please have a look. Let's not smile, let's smile with a grin. Very important. I thought I should highlight this point to you guys. The third one again is with regard to, again, a draconian, I mean, this is my take on that. Recovery of tax from distinct persons. I don't know how many of you noticed that in the law. It was not highlighted. Earlier, there was a sales tax demand in, say, Maharashtra. That fellow used to send a notice there, try to recover from you. Now, the government has got the power. If there is a recovery which is due in UP, he will send a notice to your Maharashtra authority and try to recover the money from there, in spite of you having 2 separate GST IDs. So they have brought in a proviso to Section 79. It says that money can be recovered from a distinct person as well. So if you look at the amendments proposed draft, you can see government was specifying everywhere it is taxpayer friendly. But my request to each one of you, go through very carefully. There are measures which are not so taxpayer friendly. With regard to things which they have not done, as rightly pointed out by Mr. Majumdar, I have a big laundry list, but I thought I should highlight. Morning, one of my friends raised the point in liquor industry. I work in chemical industry. ENA, the taxability of ENA and this rectified spirit. Actually, this is before the council. Everybody of us are aware of it. But I have got rulings from this Telangana, a central government, not a ruling, it's exactly a query to my answer to my query, where a central government authority says this is under GST, and the state government authority says, please deposit VAT, otherwise you will get a recovery notice. And they both sit together nearby. One of the points we wanted to take up with the government, MEIS scripts, I think any of the exporters will have that MEIs or SEI scripts. They have thankfully brought, made it as exempted, but how are you going to reverse the credit? How do you compute the reversal of the proportioned input tax credit? Instead, they could have levied 1% tax on MEI scripts and allowed it. Now, how do I reverse? How do I identify the proportionate credit attributable to a sale of script? We have taken up with the government on this issue. Probably they could have included in the Schedule 3. They have not done it. This is one point which we have raised, but it has not been considered. Then interest on this payment to the vendors, 180 days. This is a very good provision. Somehow they stopped it. I had a doubt. I wanted to ask the experts, advocates, etc., what the GST Council recommends, whether the government can reject it. That they said that yes, the government can do it. But I am not very sure why it is being done. It's a good provision, with non-payment of interest, that they have not considered. They have gone back. And apart from this, there was one point which I thought industry wanted, upfront exemption for deemed exports. This the government has not considered. We have been representing this. There is no provision for claiming the refund in the system. So this point has not been considered by the government. And last but least, how many of you have SEZs here? I am not aware. If you see SEZ availing input tax credit was in doubt. The government has now amended the unjust enrichment provision, and by in the process allowed the SEZ to take the credit. But then what happened to the credits which have been already taken by the SEZ in the first 10 months or so? There is no clarity. Probably this could have been retrospective, whatever. This is one point which we represented from our industry. It has not been considered. I think with that remarks.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Devarajan. You have really opened our eyes wide awake, and a lot of issues are still there. We can open the floor for some of the questions and answers, perhaps, straight away from the audience. We had certain things, but then time will not permit now.
Sir, you mentioned about a draconian provision where the buyer has paid the tax to the seller and the seller has not deposited. I don't think this problem is going to ever go away. In the VAT case, Delhi VAT case of Arise India, the High Court very clearly stated that unless the department can prove collusion, the input credit must be allowed. And this has been the SLP filed by the department was rejected in the Supreme Court recently. However, the VAT department continues and continues to issue such notices and block such credits. And what they do, I think it will happen here also, regardless of whatever amendment or they do.
In defiance of Supreme Court order?
Yes, sir. When has the department followed Supreme Court orders in any of
the... His point is, it was a precedent set in a VAT
scenario.
Will that apply in GST as well or not?
Thank you, Mr. Neeraj and Mr. Dutt, for conducting the discussion. And thank you, all the panelists.